Watching recon data coming in as we speak, and Jeremy, and I can chat about this if you want, but the one thing that I'm noticing just in the last few moments, the NOAA P3 Orion is investigating the storm and is still finding winds at Category 5 level using their SFMR reader there.
Yeah, and it's likely, I don't have that in front of me there, but was it in the northeast quadrant probably that they're seeing some of the strongest winds?
Northeast quad. Actually, that's the looks like the northwest quadrant. So like the northern eye wall, but northwest quadrant looks like.
Okay, yeah. So obviously we're now within about a day and a half of this approaching Jamaica. So if we could look at that, I've had questions posed to me. I have a cruise coming up, I have a trip to Jamaica. What will the island look like after this? But I know some of the models take it right over it. At least it should be weakening some. That doesn't provide a lot of relief when you still have maybe, whether it's a Category 2, 3 hurricane moving overhead.
So this is the forecast cone from the National Hurricane Center. Last cone came out at 5 a.m. We'll have a new cone within the hour or so by, 10:47, 11 o'clock. But notice it keeps it as a very powerful hurricane as it approaches Jamaica. So yeah, a lot of questions. One of my wife's former colleagues was even mentioning like, "Hey, I'm on the island of Jamaica, trying to perhaps get out tomorrow. Is what time do we think the airport's going to close or anything like that?" But based on the current cone, notice by Wednesday 2 a.m. it's approaching, and by Wednesday 2 p.m. the center of circulation is essentially right over the island of Jamaica. So I would say sunrise tomorrow through sunset tomorrow is going to be a rough one for our friends over there in Jamaica, Jeremy.
Yeah, and I've been to Jamaica years ago, but there's definitely some high terrain there. One of the resort areas, Negril, is kind of on that southwest side, which would be more directly exposed. You get to Montego Bay, that's a little bit more on that north-northwest side of the island. So some of the resort areas, I'm sure people are, as you mentioned, kind of worried to say the least. I was talking with someone from the Savannah area that was in St. Lucia as Beryl was going through the southern Windward Islands. Now, St. Lucia saw some minimal impacts, maybe some tropical storm force wind gusts, but I think it was more the anxiety, the stress of a storm coming that close. And you're kind of, once you're on those islands, you're trapped because they start to shut things down.
Well, and one of my colleagues has family in Grenada and was talking about how, it's like on a good day, transportation in and out of the island isn't exactly the easiest. So, Montego Bay, the airport there may be a little bit easier in and out, but it's not like we're bringing in double the aircraft if people wanted to get in and out. So that becomes certainly a concern for the folks that live there. So that's kind of the idea on the forecast for Jamaica, a major hurricane hit. And then afterward, Jeremy, let's talk a little bit about how, as Beryl were to work toward the Yucatan Peninsula, the overall forecast thinking is that it would start to weaken just a little bit.
Yeah, and as it goes into the western part of the Caribbean, there should be some additional wind shear. There'll be a land interaction somewhere on the Yucatan area. And then if it makes it into the southern Gulf of Mexico, a lot of models show a much weaker system there, potentially just more of a rainmaker once we get to that point. Obviously, the concern is right now is it's still a major hurricane. We'll see what happens with the winds at the 11 a.m. update. If keep those kind of around 160 or higher, being a Category 5, or if we start to see a little weakening trend today, it'd be great if we could get this storm much weaker over the next 24 hours as it approaches Jamaica. One thing that really stood out to me, we were talking about this at work, is we have a Category 5 hurricane, and this is such a fast-moving storm.
I mean, when you look at it, the forward progression is, what is it? It's 20, 22 miles an hour. And usually, Jeremy, you need the storm to slow down in order to get that Category 5 status. And a couple of the academia meteorological folks have already been talking about how this is. You could look at the calendar and say it's the earliest Category 5 on record, and that's already worth noting. But you could also look at it and say, yeah, but there's so many more pieces to it. Like, how did the models really struggle? How did that forward momentum not, it's like there's a lot of pieces to this that are at least very interesting to stop, go back, look at, and try and study.
Yeah, I think this will be a hurricane that's done a lot of case studies, a lot of analysis with it. And we're now in the day and age where we do so many of these recon missions in there, so we have reliable data, satellite data. I mean, every minute, the GOES floater satellite is updating, which gives us just spectacular visible and IR views.
Right. Right. I mean, it's remarkable. And then we take that recon data and we put it into the computer forecast models, right? So let's take and just kind of do a little bit of a deeper dive on what the computer models are saying, because you were talking about getting questions from folks that are either vacationing or kind of live down there in Jamaica. So this is our in-house models that we run, and it's the 6E run. So it's the most recent run that we have. Jeremy, do you want to take this or do you want me to run through this?
You can go through that because I think you've been able to preview it. But one thing I want to say is that IBM model or whatever we want to call it now, historically has done very well with tropical forecasting. So we'll let Eric take this and kind of show when this goes near Jamaica.
Yeah. So this is that model. We run it. We call it in Orlando, we call it the Futurecast model. But let me just run this through time, okay? So first off, one thing to note, this is going to be 8 p.m. tonight, kind of due south of the Dominican Republic-Haiti border there. Still a major hurricane. So that's one interesting thing to point out. Another interesting thing is, and you'll see from our Futurecast model to the global GFS and the global euro, there is some intensity differences. Our model is saying that this should remain as a very powerful hurricane as it approaches Jamaica. All right. So continuing through time. All right. This is going to be overnight tonight. We wake up tomorrow morning, 7, 8 a.m. The core of the winds are still offshore of Jamaica, but definitely approaching. Let me take it and zoom it in even more. And this is the magic of computers today, is we're able to, you know, manipulate the model so much. So the winds really start picking up late morning tomorrow. Okay. This is going to be 10 a.m. tomorrow. Those browns, whites, deep reds. I mean, that's major hurricane force winds. That's where the worst of the winds go. And according to that Futurecast model, look at that. By 12, 1, 2 o'clock, it's bringing 100 plus mile per hour winds on that eastern tip there of Jamaica, and then bringing it in, and almost the entire island is going to be getting hurricane force winds. Now, according to our model, at least, the center of circulation would roll along the northern shore. And this is going to be an interesting, you know, and Jeremy, bring you into this. This is going to be an interesting case study of if it stays along the northern side, then some of those hurricane force winds would miss. Whereas if it stays, kind of goes right through the middle of the island, you know, the entire island could see those very powerful winds.
Yeah, I don't know if there's like a best case scenario where you're talking about an island, but at least this particular model kind of skirts that north side, which may give a little bit lower impact to some of those southern coastal areas. And again, I mentioned like Negril, kind of on that more southwest or western area, and then Montego Bay. It almost has the eye scooting right by Montego Bay, just off from that. So I would say this model, at least compared to some others, might be a hair farther to the north.
Yeah. So it'll definitely be interesting to see. Hold on a second. I've got somebody trying to log into my computer here, which is just so fun.
And it's on replay now, right?
So that's okay. All right. I texted my chief Manolfi. Hopefully he got that memo. All right. So that's where that goes. Then afterward, let's kind of progress this beyond, because the Caymans kind of become a threat. And one interesting thing, like notice here, even our Futurecast model, keeping it as 100 plus mile per hour winds approaching kind of Grand Cayman. And it's, you know, this is where now casting becomes a struggle, because it's like, if it goes a little north, if it goes a little further south, this could be the difference between a massive impact and a lesser impact on Jamaica and the Cayman Islands, Jeremy. And then of course, beyond that, once it gets toward the Yucatan Peninsula, even our Futurecast model, thankfully, shows the storm starting to weaken, but it's still a decent Cat 2/Cat 3 hurricane as it approaches the Yucatan Peninsula at that point.
Yeah, this is definitely pretty wild, a little bit different than what we've seen on some other models, which start to weaken it a little bit quicker. So you have, obviously, you have Cancun showing there. You also have Cozumel Island off from east of kind of east-southeast there of the Cancun area. You have Riviera Maya. So you have all those huge tourist areas, Tulum, from Cancun down to Tulum and points in between there. That's right. Where all the huge tourist areas are located. So obviously we think about the tourists here because we get the questions from our viewers, but you think about the locals as well that live down in that area. So we have some pretty big areas about to be impacted. And even if you don't take a direct strike from this, we always talk about just impact. So when you look at Jamaica, higher terrain there over parts of the island. Obviously, this could be doing just all kinds of rain. So then you start to think about flood threat on parts of Jamaica. Then the Cayman Islands, maybe it brushes by there, impacts them. And then one of the final stops before it bumps into Mexico would be Cozumel, Cancun, and potentially down towards Riviera Maya.
Right. It's kind of interesting. Like I was just there at the Yucatan on your vacation. You went to what? Italy. I went there to the Yucatan. And I just remember I was in one of those Caglows and it was like cloudy and wet. And I just remember thinking like, man, these areas, they get pelted with hurricanes. And here we are a couple of weeks later. And it's like, man, these areas could get pelted with a hurricane. So, you know, I don't like seeing that.
All right. Well, let's talk about kind of where we're at hurricane season. I know you put some of the numbers together here, and especially when it comes to like ACE score, that is just going to be sort of exploding here, jumping up very fast because we're going to continue to add some hurricane days onto this and also the strength of this. So those numbers will be going up very quickly. Is that for 2024?
Oh yeah, I didn't change the graphic. Hold on, I'll fix that.
Okay. All right, I just wanted to make it clear. I mean, I know what we know what it is, but in case anyone's looking, so already the A score is already at a 15. The average is 2.5. Last year we were up to a 9, and we'll see this number jump very fast. I mean, we were definitely expecting ACE to be above average this year. But I think we were talking earlier, we weren't really anticipating a Category 5 hurricane this early in the season.
Right. I mean, the water temperatures we know have been at historic levels the entire time. So, you know, this is not far-fetched, right? It's the first year that we've really had this kind of fuel before. So it's kind of one of those interesting things, right? So three named storms. The average through today is 1.3. Last year we had 4, but notice our ACE score higher because the storm this year, Beryl, is significantly stronger. So kind of one of those interesting things. All right, Jeremy, let me switch over. I won't take as much time on it, but I do want to switch over and take a look at the GFS and the European computer models just so that we can kind of see the progression of all of these models, right? So here we are, GFS model, and we'll just take it through time here. Watch how the GFS approaching Jamaica weakens it a little bit. Still a hurricane, but doesn't look like a major. Looks more like a Cat 1/Cat 2. So, the in-house model keeping it stronger, American GFS weakening it. And, you know, real quick, Jeremy, to the point that we were looking at, like, it looks like we could have hit kind of peak intensity. You know, maybe it's already starting that weakening trend.
And we're hoping so. We think on the IR satellite, again, that's not taking into account any of the drop zone data from real-time hurricane hunters that are in the storm. But kind of the eye test right now is it looks like maybe that western side is starting to get impacted a little bit, but obviously, I mean, it's still a major hurricane. Right. Hopefully, the more we get into this afternoon, this evening, it will start to look a little more ragged there. We could get some winds to start to impact it in the upper levels, but until then, I think they should be preparing on Jamaica for Category 2, 3 type hurricane.
I mean, at the end of the day, you know, we can't promise it's going to weaken. They need to prepare for whatever this thing could be. All right. So back to the model real quick. I don't want to spend too much time on it because we get the idea, right? This kind of takes it through the center of the island, keeping most of the worst winds on the north side of the island and then bringing into the Caymans kind of a lower end hurricane one, something to that effect. And then after that, bringing it over toward like Cancun, Cozumel, Tulum. And then once it gets into the Gulf of Mexico, Jeremy, weakening it to a tropical storm and bringing that tropical storm energy up into Texas. as a much weaker storm system.
Yeah, the European computer model, I think that one takes it more in, once it's in that far southern Gulf of Mexico, runs it more into Mexico, and maybe some rains reach Texas, but at least the operational run that we were looking at crosses the Yucatan, weakens it quite a bit, and then as it moves into the southern Gulf of Mexico, kind of keeps it more like a west-northwest trajectory.
Right. As far as ensembles go, and we won't spend too much time on this, but here's the ensemble plots. All those kind of feather lines are ensembles, and you can see the National Hurricane Center's cone there. So they're kind of going right down the middle. They may end up kind of at the end, starting to shift that a little more and more to the right to bring that remnant moisture, whatever it is, after the Yucatan, a little more toward Texas or Louisiana. But it's, you know, we have to see how long it stays strong and how quickly it weakens. I think those are going to be big tests.
Yeah. And then once that's gone, I know people are also like, hey, you've been talking about this area of interest out in the Atlantic. Where is that going to be moving? And we actually have a little bit better news to pass along with that. I think the models initially, one, to have barrels strong enough, and then two, we're kind of ramping this next disturbance up in the Atlantic as it moves in a westerly direction. But now the chance of development with this has dropped down to 30%. So I would say confidence is maybe like low medium on this one. We'll just watch to see what happens.
Right.
Our focus is definitely on the hurricane right now. But this one trailing it is almost in a very similar path. So hopefully it doesn't develop. If it does, it would be Debbie.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's kind of the interesting thing, right? Like the models have been hinting at this, but one really nice way to visualize where we're at is of course, by looking at the Saharan dust. If you look at how Beryl has been avoiding it, but notice around Jamaica, there's a pretty decent little pocket of Saharan dust there. And the open Atlantic is absolutely covered in that dust. And if we advance this to the kind of dust modeling, look at these next couple of days. I mean, holy cannoli, you want to talk about the Sahara injected over the Atlantic. There is dust over that entire basin, wave after wave after wave of Saharan dust, Jeremy.
And I think that will help to give us a little bit of a lull once we get past probably this first week or so of July. Some of the other, then we should see a little bit quieter part of the pattern return for the middle part of July. Mm-hmm. We do have a little opportunity, maybe 19th, 25th, could be a little low somewhere, Gulf or off the southeast coast. But really then our attention will start to go into that front half, I believe, of August, kind of like the early to middle part of August. We start to get parts of the pattern that we have identified as being a little more conducive for tropical development. So then you're almost into the heart of hurricane season. You're sort of like that mid-August through early October is really the peak of the season when climatologically most of your storms develop. So we'll have to watch August, September, early October. We do that each and every year, but when we get some of these signals back, then I think it is definitely going to be spelling some trouble once again.
So a couple of people were asking earlier kind of how this fits into our long-term patterns. Jeremy, you want to kind of dive into that just a little bit?
Yeah. So, I mean, we had highlighted July 3rd to the 10th for around Yucatan, maybe parts of the Gulf of Mexico. And those areas, this will be moving into that. But we went back and did a little deeper dive. So Eric and I really spend a lot of our long-range forecasting time on coastal US. So we went back and we were breaking down the 500 millibar charts, which we do each and every year. And right near Jamaica on November the 15th, key part of the pattern there, there was an upper level low right over that. And we've been talking about this a lot. Our cycle duration's around about 45 to 48, 48 and a half days. Well, back on November the 15th, that low, that's kind of in that July 3rd to 10th frame as well. That was a complex part of the pattern. There's a couple lows going on. It's one we've highlighted, but that would be a 40, right at 46 days. So is long and troughs. So where these will reach maximum intensity, where they want to fall into these. And it seems like kind of that, if you drew a line, it would be almost the Gulf down into parts of the Caribbean for this part of the pattern. And then again, we'll be watching this because this is going to cycle back. And as I mentioned, and you can go back and look at our write-up from March the 1st, we mentioned this was a complex part of the pattern because we've always had multiple lows ongoing.
Right. Right. So there, if you look right at the very kind of bottom of the screen where it says minus 80 and there's a low, there was an upper low in that vicinity at that time frame. So, you know, this is where forecasting, you know, long range forecasting is a little difficult, but it's there. So we do focus all of our attention on the United States. But this is, you know, there was a clear November 15th, 2023 signal of this area, this part of the pattern. So it's there. And it's just a matter of kind of watching.
And when we did our forecast, I mean, we highlighted that, what was it, like November 14th to 18th, I think we just said the 15th to 16th in our March 1st forecast and talked about that. One thing we did notice is that when in that time window, when these lows got closer to the Yucatan, they started to weaken. So I think this will be a good test this time. Let's see what happens when this gets close to the Yucatan, because these lows in past cycles, once they get closer to the Yucatan, they tend to weaken. So we'll watch that kind of closely.
Yeah, for sure. But it's interesting nonetheless. So I know a couple of people were asking about the long range forecast stuff, and I, you know, I wanted to make sure to address that, Jeremy, because I think it's important.
Yeah, and then if you take a look, also we had that area of interest. I know we were on vacation. We would have talked about this extensively.
Right.
I think in our long range forecast, we had like June. What was it, like 20 to 26, or somewhere in that time window?
Yeah.
We had that area of interest move right into the southeast coast, and that was again right in our time window.
Mm-hmm.
Coming up here as this passes Jamaica, heads to the Yucatan. That is also right in our highlighted time window. So. What we're looking for are these to fall into their long wave of kind of positions.
Right.
And this is eventually going to, as it moves past Jamaica, head into sort of one of those that we had identified.
Well, and interestingly enough, too, if you look down the pike, like the models are talking about this kind of trying to curve toward like Texas, Louisiana. If this were not focused, if this piece of energy were not more focused on the upper low from November, if it were more of the surface low from November,
right,
then this would, that weakness in the trough would be what drives it right up to Florida. You know, like that,
right,
that pathway is opening. It's just, this is more focused on the upper air version versus the surface one. So, you know, this is why, like, forecasting is hard.
And there are also, I mean, we could, anyone that wants to go back and look at the other cycles, there has been at least two lows in this part of the pattern.
Yeah.
So what's saying that a different one won't be the dominant one the next time?
Right.
It's complex, but hey, that's why we give the time window and we say, hey, watch this time frame.
Yeah.
Sort of these areas. And now as we move forward, we'd be looking at probably, I think it's like later in August when this would come back around. So I don't know. This early in the season to see a Category 5 hurricane, I don't think I want to change our forecast at all right now.
No.
But one thing is, if we have a major hurricane this early in the season, I guess if there's one thing I would be like, ooh, I'm like, maybe there'll be more major hurricanes than what we forecast.
But when we put out our forecast, if you recall, we had calculated a higher number of stronger storms this year. So to that point, you know, at least our thought process was there. Do we end up missing the numbers? I mean, listen,
I'll
do the best
yet
we can. You know, I'm not going to sit here and play Monday morning quarterback on a Saturday. You can play Monday morning quarterback on Monday, but it's still Saturday night. We're not even to Sunday yet. So like, you know, just watching, playing it out, you know, and this is what I was saying on my coffee talk this morning. It's like, you know, when anybody wants to start questioning anything, it's like, look, we put our forecast out and then it's there. We're watching to follow it, but I'm not going to sit here and start freaking out because it's following the pathways. It's doing what we expect.
Right.
You know, does this become more dominant than this? Well, sure, but let's just watch. But to me, it's absolutely a clear cut sign of, you know, we are exactly where it's supposed to be.
And also, to the probably most active parts of the pattern that we identified, we're going to be through those here once we get through about the next 5 to about 7 days or so.
Yeah.
Then there's probably going to be a lull, and then we'll have to really watch as we get into, I think, August again.
Yeah, 100%. And I think that the models are all backing that up. And so, yeah. All right. Any questions? Let's see. Any questions, comments, concerns? Let's see here. Desiree, in the southern part of Puerto Rico, the impact of Beryl has begun to be felt. There are some strong winds, rain, and strong waves that are already entering the streets. So there you go. Just looking, these are the gusts. And you can see on the south side of Puerto Rico there, gusting to 31. Even on the north side of Puerto Rico, gusting to 28, 27. Look at Cuba out near Guantanamo, gusting to 35. And sustained winds, these are kind of the sustained winds, sustained at 27 on the south side of Puerto Rico, sustained to 18, 23, 27. So it's definitely breezy, but those areas, thankfully, are not getting the full brunt of the storm system.
I did see some video out of Puerto Rico, which surprised me a little bit. It did look like they at least had some tropical storm force wind gusts in parts of the area,
yeah,
or parts of that island. Again, there's some elevation there, so I'm not exactly sure where on the island that was taken. But this is showing the wind field now is starting to expand. It was so concentrated as it went through the southern Windward Islands.
Yeah.
So that hurricane core of winds was pretty tight to the storm.
Right.
And now this definitely looks like it's starting to expand.
Well, it's gone through a couple of eyewall replacement cycles. And, you know, for now, it's like, and this is where tail Doppler radar will come into play, right? Like, does it try to do another eyewall replacement cycle, or is that dry air and wind shear finally starting to take its toll on the storm? I suppose we'll continue to watch and progress this. Somebody had mentioned, Jeremy, and I have to laugh when I see this, y'all calculated being the worst year every year. And of course, you're going to get it right every once in a while. I don't think that that's, Jeremy, what you and I do at all. But
no, and I always tell people, they're like, oh, you said this or that. And I said, well, you can always go back and look, because our forecasts are documented.
Yeah.
We put them out March the 1st. We kind of get our forecast out, which is great. We have a method to do that. But also before all the other forecasts are out. So we aren't like looking at all the other forecasts and then tweaking ours based on someone else's. Ours is kind of out there.
Yeah.
And away we go.
Yeah. Yeah. Mike's asking if that's dry air making its way into Beryl. You know, one thing I could do as I'm sitting here, I could swap out the satellite to the water vapor and we could check that.
I mean, I'm looking at the IR over here on a side panel here, and it looks like the western eyewall has some crazy thunderstorms that just developed. If you look at the IR,
standby checking.
Definitely, if you zoom down just within, I'm looking at the 1 minute.
One minute. All right, standby.
Yeah.
You're making me work here, Nelson.
But I think if you zoom down, just that western eyewall has just within probably the last several minutes, it looks like there's some very strong or at least cold cloud tops on that western eye.
You're making me work. Last 3 hours, last 1 hour. Okay. Give it a second to buffer data.
Yep. But I think that's one thing that's great now with the technology is we get the 1 minute look at the storm, and they can just put these floater satellites over it and just stays there.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So there's that. IR goes 16.
Pretty color table on it.
Yeah.
And if you zoom down, the at least what I'm looking at here, you can see that that kind of brighter pink there on the western eyewall. So those have just really flared up here in the last probably 30 minutes.
All right. Click save, let it go buffer some data. All right. It's buffering. Just a second. All right. It's going to go buffer. It's going to be a little glitchy for a few. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're right. Look at those colder, those purples. Yeah. See, it's, you know, is any of that dry air sneaking in? It's interesting. It's interesting to look at.
Yep.
And that's where Recon does such a great job.
Right. Yep. That's the real time data. And then that gets ingested into the model. So hopefully in the end that helps us provide a more accurate forecast for some of the islands and also Yucatan farther down the road.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just this kind of stuff, you know, for folks that live on Jamaica, all the data that we can get on the storm now to get into the models will help the forecast. It's not going to change the eventuality, but it will help the forecast so that the good people of Jamaica and the Caymans can at least have as much notice as they can.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
absolutely. So, yeah. All right, we'll be monitoring this today. So obviously if you're in Orlando, check out Eric. If you're in Savannah, I'll have the updates coming up on WJCL, but kind of a eventful track in the tropics here for early July.
We'll have plenty more where that came from. But for now, thank you, Jeremy, for joining us. We'll do it again many times this every Tuesday at 10 a.m. Got it, people? Join us.
I have cleared my Tuesdays for the rest of hurricane season.
And I will do the darndest to do the same thing. Jeremy, thank you very much, my friend from beautiful Central Florida. I am WESH 2 meteorologist Eric Burris.
And in Savannah, Georgia, I am WJCL 22 Chief Meteorologist Jeremy Nelson.
See you, buddy.